Good afternoon, and thank you very much for having me here today. My name is Jeroen, as already very well pronounced, and together with Nell Gray from the Manson Unit in London, we have conducted a qualitative study to better understand the health perceptions and health-seeking behavior of communities living in Kamrangachar and Hazaribagh in Dhaka, Bangladesh. Our study is titled Working to Stay Healthy. I'll take you through our study in the following four steps. First, I will explain a little bit more about the background and the study context, followed by the methodology, study findings, and finally the conclusion and the results of the implementation. This study has been conducted in the south of Dhaka, in Kamrangachar and in Hazaribagh, marked red in the enlargement. Combined, they are the biggest slum area of Bangladesh. Approximately 500,000 people live here on 6 square kilometers. That's 80,000 people per square kilometer. In comparison here to Delhi, it's approximately 25,000 people per square kilometer. So you can imagine how busy and how crowded this area is. Most of the labor here is done in the semi-formal industries of leather, plastic, garments, and metals. This area, and specifically Hazaribagh in the top red, where most of Bangladesh's leather production takes place, is one of the most polluted places on the planet, the fifth most polluted place on the planet, actually. In 2013, MSF OCA started an urban health care program to respond to the needs of this community, resulting in an occupational health program for male and female, and a sexual and reproductive health program for women between the age of 13 to 18 years old. At the time of this study, the program run one main clinic and 6 satellite clinics. Currently, they chose a more centralized setup, and the 3 marked in red, they are still remaining. So, rapid urbanization in middle and low-income countries have resulted in a rapid growth of informal settings. Big cities have difficulties handling the influx of these uncontrolled growths. In Dhaka, it is estimated that the current 15 million people living there now will expand to 23 million over the coming 8 years. Working in these rapidly expanding and constantly changing settings is uncharted territory for MSF, and this came with a lot of questions and uncertainties. Running the program, it was realized that in contrast to the expectations, the number of patients visiting the clinic was low, despite the high population density and poor economic situation. The question rose why there was no bigger uptake in these free services. This study is focused on better understanding the way health is perceived and placed in the socio-economic setting of this community, and the answers of this study will help the program to tailor the services better to the needs of the community. The study was conducted amongst 40 patients in 3 groups: factory workers, women in the age of 13 to 49, and key stakeholders in the community, such as health workers, imams, and doctors. To enhance the credibility of our sample, we used purposive maximum variation sampling and divided the number of interviews over the 4 areas that I mentioned earlier. In this study, we've used participant-led interviews based on the topic guide. Because the study was conducted by 2 researchers and cultural gender sensitivity did not allow for interviews to be conducted by the opposite sex, we needed to ensure that there was internal validity between the interviewers. For this, we used, obviously, the topic guide, and we had a constant feedback loop between me and Nell, the second researcher in this study. As this study is a qualitative study in a rather unique setting, only the concepts of this study can be further generalized. However, this study itself can be used in comparison to similar settings or similar studies. A limitation to our study was that we encountered that a high percentage of the population was factory workers, which created a false division between the group women and factory workers. Even though at the start of each interview we made clear to what group they belonged, we still had significant overlap due to self-prioritization of issues. For this study, we obtained ethical approval from both MSF and the local board. So on to the study findings. Our study shows three main themes, which I will explain in further detail in the coming slides. First of all, health is seen as an asset to sustain a person or a family's socio-economic position. Secondly, contextual factors and barriers have a major influence on the decisions being taken. And lastly, in a fragmented healthcare system that is experienced in this area, informal networks are the most reliable source for search of qualitative care. So on to finding one. First of all, people feel a strong responsibility to remain healthy. Obviously, we all do. But in this setting, it was the socio-economic limitations that was the single most persuasive determinant for health-seeking behavior. Healthcare decisions were made in many cases a family decision, especially when it came to women. The family took a collective decision, and often this was linked to the financial implication. Many workers in this area work over 60 hours a week, hardly earning enough to make ends meet. Therefore, they lack the freedom to take the necessary measures to maintain their health. This status quo, however, is accepted in this community. Earning money is prioritized, and health is reduced to an asset or a tool for this purpose. In this context, time is money. So if self-care, meaning taking extra vitamins, rest, or extra food, did not quickly result in improvement of the symptoms, the first step taken was to visit a local pharmacy. Local pharmacies are available on every corner of the streets in Kamrangachar. Here they were searching for a quick solution for their symptoms. Such actions have been proven to have a negative impact on the health of this and other low-income urban areas. At the same time, our study shows a level of mistrust and wariness. The pharmacy drugs were seen as a temporary relief, curing symptoms, not causes. And people are very aware of the risk of over-medicating. The motivation of their actions resulted from the commodification of functional health, as I mentioned before, to maintain the family's economic position. Decisions made were closely linked to the self or socially attributed seriousness of a disease. Experienced symptoms, not a disease yet. When the pharmacy treatment was ineffective, or when symptoms were unknown or the ability to work was tampered, the symptoms were seen as serious enough to consider seeking qualitative care in the form of a hospital visit or a qualified doctor. How am I doing on time? But once they went beyond the pharmacy, healthcare was characterized as a fragmented landscape of partial services, of which many were poorly regulated and varying in quality of care. This, in combination with inadequate secondary and tertiary care, ruled out a comprehensive healthcare system for this community. The limited knowledge that came with this in a highly fragmented and unregulated healthcare system creates a constant uncertainty on the availability and the quality of care for this community. People consulted different providers, often in quick succession, often resulting in differing diagnoses and incomplete treatments. In this context, formal health advice and support is poor. Choices informed by previous experience, recommendations of their own networks, and other care providers. While there's little evidence of information flows in urban slum communities, word of mouth seems to be the most important source of information for qualitative care for this community. However, in some cases, this obviously also resulted in contradicting suggestions leading to further frustration by not getting the care that you seek. In conclusion, Improving health in this complex setting demands a health system that includes a comprehensive healthcare model, tailored to the rapid needs and effective treatment for this community. This seems obviously logical, because that would be in every setting. However, in this specific setting, in doing so, there should be an emphasis on encouraging trust between the healthcare provider and the community. And thirdly, community-based mechanisms with an emphasis on health education will expand information and services flows, particularly to the most vulnerable groups, people in this community. Based on our study, a number of recommendations have been made to the project, and the project has implemented these. First of all, they have improved the access to our services. They're collaborating with factory owners to ensure attendance during work hours are possible, and they extended the opening hours of the clinic so people can also attend after work time, which was a big problem. Besides that, for the SRH pillar for women, the age limit went up from 18 to 25 to serve a broader group of women in this community. Further, they worked on sensitizing the staff and outreach workers on the importance of the relationship with the community and on building trust. And lastly, they're looking into the possibility of using word of mouth communication to spread health messages deeper into the community. Finally, I would like to extend a special thanks to Sabir, Adiba, Fatima, and the whole Kemrangichar team, and to our translators for their support to this study. Thank you very much.
Oh, right away. There's a question right there.
Hello, Jean-Francois from MSF Brazil. I was just wondering if in the interviews came about alternative therapeutic options and health-seeking behaviors such as traditional, spiritual,
yes.
Personal.
Yes, it did come up, but it was marginal. They sought alternative health care, but for very specific diseases. That was one that came up most for the alternative healers, but people realized, they actually mentioned that they thought this was the better type of healthcare, but it took too long, and they needed a quicker solution. So that's why they went to pharmacies or beyond to a doctor. Does that answer the question? Yes? Okay.
Were you able to put these recommendations, implement these recommendations, and did you see an increase in patient flow?
Yes. Oh, I forgot to mention that at the last slide. We actually, I got confirmation from the project that they saw a significant increase of patients visiting the clinics. So it has helped. So I hope this was the reason, but yeah.
Thank you. A very important query I have, was the issue of mental health covered? Awareness. Thank you.
Well, it was a self-prioritized interviews. In cases, obviously, it came up, but it was not. That didn't come forward as one of our main results. Obviously, people deal with a lot of mental and physical problems in these areas. So yes, it did come up. If that answers the question.
Before we go to the next session, just a comment. I think it's a, oh, there is a.
Sorry, sir.
Did your part.
Okay. Myself, Faisal, I just want to have one thing that,
yes.
For the health seeking behavior, which was the best community engagement strategy which was used in the part of the Bangladesh?
I'm sorry. Which was the one that worked the best?
Best strategy, community engagement strategy.
Well, they're looking into, well, they have an outreach team that goes into the community with the health message. We found in our study that the word of mouth is a very important tool, and trust is a very important element in that. People, tend to doubt the health workers, since they were not the only health workers in this community. There were other groups active that also spread a health message, and there were also groups active that went by doors to sell medicine. So there was also a mistrust towards our outreach workers. That's why we advised to use the word of mouth tool to get this message through key stakeholders in the community towards a broader group.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I'm Mitchell. I'm the medical coordinator for MSF Mission in Bangladesh. So perhaps I can add more on some of the questions and clarifications. Regarding the outreach questions, we have a huge network of outreach workers. So they are out in the community. So what they do is like they go house to house, give more information about our specific services, which is available in our clinic, which is the services for the occupational health, services for the adolescent, sexual and reproductive health, and also the SGBV program. And we also engage schools, we engage college, we have a peer education group where we invite adolescents to come and have those health education sessions. So I hope that answers your question. Mm-hmm.
Some of